हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू डीएनए डीट्स यूट्यूब चैनल। टुडेज टॉपिक इज रेस्ट्रिक्शन एंडोन्यूक्लियेजेस प्रॉपर्टीज। व्हाट आर रेस्ट्रिक्शन एंडोन्यूक्लियेजेस? एंजाइम्स दैट कट दैट अटैक एंड डाइजेस्ट इंटरनल रीजन्स ऑफ द डीएनए ऑफ एन इन्वेडिंग बैक्टीरियोफेज बट नॉट दैट ऑफ होस्ट। They bind to specific sequence of DNA molecule. They break the phosphodiester bonds that link adjacent nucleotides in DNA molecule. This is a small introduction of restriction endonuclease. Restriction endonuclease are nucleases which cuts the internal region of DNA molecule. That's a first property. Second thing is that they're very specific about the restriction site. So once they identify their recognition sequence, then followed by there is a restriction. So these restriction endonucleases binds to the recognition sequence, then later they'll cut the DNA molecule. So restriction endonuclease are enzymes which are basically nuclease, cut the internal region at specific sites. Today, in this lecture, we'll talk about the nomenclature of restriction endonuclease, rotational symmetry, length of restriction sites, and cutting pattern of restriction site. The discovery of many restriction enzymes are called for a uniform system for nomenclature. When you have more enzymes, if they don't have a proper system to nomenclature them, then there would be a chance to rediscovering of already discovered one. So to avoid that, Nathan and Smith called for a system. Based upon that, they have nomenclatured the restriction endonuclease. For example, if you take ECO-R1, whose restriction site is GAATTC, you see, E stands for genus, Escherichia. And CO stands for species, that is coli. R stands for strain. And the I, or one, Roman letter one, stands for first endonuclease isolated from this system. This is the order of discovery of restriction systems from that system gives the number. So ECO-R1 means E stands for genus, CO stands for species, R stands for strain, and Roman letter one stands for order of discovery of the restriction site. So ECO-R1 is the first restriction site discovered from this Escherichia coli RY13 strain. We'll go for one more example. So if you want to remember this one, you can make it GSSOD. G stands for genus, S stands for species, S stands for strain, OD means order of discovery. BAMH1, this is GGATCC. You see, B, genus Bacillus, AM, species Amyloliquefaciens, H stands for strain, and 1, first endonuclease isolated from this system. This is how nomenclature has developed for all enzyme discovered, and that is following till date. This is the most important one of restriction endonuclease, especially type 2 restriction endonuclease system. They have restriction sites who's having a rotational symmetry. See, they cut DNA which have two-fold axis of rotational symmetry or palindrome. Those sequences sound similar by backward or forward. What is twofold axis of rotational symmetry? It means an object that repeats themselves when it rotates 180 degrees centigrade. When an object that repeats itself or themselves when it rotates 180 degrees centigrade is called as a twofold axis of rotational symmetry. Onefold means an object repeats themselves when it rotates 360 degree orientation. That's called as a one-fold axis of rotational symmetry. If you say three-fold, that object is rotates 120 degrees, then it resembles, it repeats its shape. That is called as a three-fold. So here, restriction sites are two-fold axis of rotational symmetry or palindromes. Means the restriction site have the same sound when you read from backward or forward. I'll explain that here. This is a restriction site, GAA-TTC of EcoR1, 5 prime to 3 prime and 3 prime to 5 prime. So here, this is a 90 degrees. This is 180. And again, this is a 90 degrees, right? If you go to the 180 degrees, that is a two-fold axis of a rotational symmetry, then also you get the same sound, you see? This is a two-fold axis of a rotational symmetry. You can see this is 90 and this is a 180. You can repeat, G-A-A-T-T-C, G-A-A-T-T-C, same sound, same, they are the same. This is what is the rotational symmetry of restriction site of type 2 restriction endonucleases. This is the most important feature of restriction endonuclease. And the second, next one is length of restriction site. These enzymes recognize the restriction site whose usually have 4 base pairs, 5 base pairs, 6 base pairs, and 8 base pairs. I'll give you a few examples here. SAU3A, whose restriction site length is GATC only 4. That's a tetranucleotide. And ALU1, that's AGCT. Next one is HE3, GGCC. These are the restriction sites whose length is only tetranucleotides. And BGL2, you see, this is AGATCT, means hexanucleotide. KPN1, GGTACC. This is again 4 nucleotide. And you say UCOR1, BAMH1, SMA1, IND3, all of them are NDE3, all of them are comes under the hexanucleotide category only. Then there is a category called octanucleotide, where restriction site length is 8 more. Not one, you see, GC, GG, CC, GC. There is a SBF1, this is also octanucleotide. So the length of the restriction site will decide the occurrence of that restriction site. Length of restriction site will decide the occurrence of restriction site in the given DNA molecule. Whenever the restriction site length is 4 mer, it tend to occur in the given DNA for every 256 base pairs. You see? Yeah, 4 base pairs, 4 to the power, 4 is the number of new bases, and this is the length of that one. So 4 to the power of 4 is 256 base pairs. So an average, a 4 or a tetranucleated restriction site occurs in the given DNA sequence for every 256 base pairs. When it comes to the 6 bases, 4 to the power of 6, it is 4,096 base pairs. When it comes to this 8 bases, 4 to the power of 8, this is a 65,536 base pairs. So when this will happen, when purines is equal to pyrimidines, that is a Charcot-Fleur, provided this is possible when purines is equal to pyrimidines, right? So, you know, one way you can tell tentative number of restriction sites may occur in the given DNA when it is tetramer, and is a hexamer, or is a tumor. You can predict that. So cutting off restriction site is most important in the gene manipulation. So there are two possibilities of two possibilities. One is cohesive, sticky, or asymmetrical. Cohesive sites or sticky one, asymmetrical ends. The second probability, second is blunt or flush or symmetrical. Cohesive means the restriction sites, when you cut with the any restriction enzyme, when they give the cohesive, they are ready to pair with the similar restriction sites very easily. Right? They're cohesive, means ready to seal. Sticky means ready to stick. Asymmetrical means they give the asymmetrical arrangement once you digest with the, those enzymes. Blunt means round up. There is flush or asymmetrical means exactly. Symmetry is possible with the blunt end. So these two types of restriction patterns are possible with the restriction enzymes. We'll go for that. Okay, what is cohesive? Let's look into that. What is the definition? Cut at one end between two bases on the same strand, second cut at opposite end of the complementary strand, a four nucleotide orang at one end of DNA fragment is formed, which is ready to form hydrogen bonds and NA. These are called as sticky ends. I'll show you. You see, this is an end three. Digestion pattern is, you see, restriction enzyme site is AAGCTT. So it is a cohesive. How do you say it is cohesive? Because restriction enzyme is cutting at 5' end, right? 5' end, and between two bases, right? On the same strand, and second cut, there's a second single strand break at opposite of the complementary strand. So you can see at one end between two bases on the same strand, and second cut is at the opposite of the complementary strand. So the enzyme is making two single strands break at 5' ends in the two strands, which is leading to the formation of orangs, 5' orang. Means unpaired. This is because of those two single strand breaks at 5' ends and the same strand, which is leading to the formation of overhangs. You see, this is a orang. You know, because of cutting, you can, that is developing an orang and the orang, which is, this is called as a protruding ends also. This kind of pattern is called as cohesive or sticky ends or asymmetrical. The cut is not at symmetry. It is not, so it is asymmetrical. So this is what is called as a sticky ends or cohesive ends or asymmetrical. Then coming to the second pattern is blunt end. Blunt end means round up. Exactly, they'll cut at same place in the restriction site. You see here, blunt ends are two single strand breaks are happening between the at same site. You see TA and AT between here and here, and which is a result of that there is no orangs. There is no, it's round up, right? So in cohesive restriction pattern, there is a formation of two categories of orangs. One is a 5' protruding ends, and second one is a 3' protruding ends. It depends on the where the restriction site is cutting. If it's cutting at the 5' end, you'll get the 5' protruding ends. If it's cutting at the 3 prime end, you get the 3 prime protruding ends. And this is a blunt end. In general, in gene manipulation, most of the time, scientists prefer to use the enzymes which are giving the cohesive ends, because they're easy to anneal with the other molecules which are having the same protruding ends. Very rarely, blunt ends enzymes are used in the gene manipulation. Yeah, you see example, ECOR1 gives the cohesive 5 termini. BAMH1 also gives the cohesive 5 termini. N3 also gives the cohesive 5 termini. And PST1 gives the cohesive 3 termini. And PME1, that is Pseudomonas minundicina, gives the blunt end. Even SMA1 also gives the blunt ends. Right? Hope you understand the concept of nomenclature, rotational symmetry, and length of restriction sites. And third one is the cutting pattern of restriction sites. Remaining properties will be discussed in the second part of the restriction enzymes properties. Thank you all for listening. We'll see you again with the one more video.